favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
Starting the recording now, and one, two, and three. Hey everyone, welcome back to Alf Will Not Be Seen Tonight, or Ethan and Mike's special presentation. See what I did there? I swapped it out a little bit there.
Mixing up a little bit. Something a little different this time.
Yeah, you never know what's going to happen to this crazy mixed up world of ours.
Man, I just don't know what to believe anymore.
So, Mike, tell me, Since we're on live mics, tell me all about your personal drug history.
Well, I'm glad you asked, because it's very relevant to tonight's episode. My personal drug history is I learned at a young age never to do drugs from this movie that we're about to watch tonight. It's called Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue.
Yes. Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue first aired on Saturday morning, I think, is a special, so which means that it counts for that part of our theme. And it also includes Garfield as one of the guest stars, one of the all-stars, one might say.
Yes.
And that is the other thing that qualifies it. The rest of it is almost completely out of our league, but we'll try to keep up.
Yeah, I don't recognize any of these other things in this. I just don't know what they are. I've never heard of anything like Huey, Dewey, and Louie, or...
What the hell is an Alf?
Yeah, or Teenage Mutant, what? I mean, I don't know. I don't know anything about cartoons.
George Bush was lying when he said it was some of our favorite characters.
Yeah. But anyway, so to bring everyone up to speed, if you haven't heard of this, it was indeed a special on television in 1990, I think.
Yes, 1990.
Where they decided that the best way to convince children not to do drugs was to get every cartoon star they could and do a massive crossover, do the Ready Player One of its day, and they would all basically tell you how uncool drugs are, and then it worked. America has no drug problem. So
if you look at the origins of the characters and how few of them were owned by the same companies at the time, this really is the biggest crossover ever. More so than Who Framed Roger Rabbit. Maybe more so than Wreck-It Ralph.
Yeah. It's got, well, who is in this thing? We've got...
Okay, Huey, Dewey, and Louie are in it. Right. That's the Disney company for you. Mm-hmm. But then you have the Ninja Turtles, who were still owned by Eastman and Laird at the time, I believe. Mm-hmm. And let's see, Garfield is there, who was still owned by Jim Davis and Paws Inc.
Right.
So, I'm not sure if by then Paws had bought him back from Universal Feature Syndicate or whatever.
Hmm. Yeah, I don't know.
But
who else do we have? We've got Winnie the Pooh.
Winnie the Pooh again, another Disney, but someone who was not created by the Disney company, unlike Huey, Dewey, and Louie.
Yeah.
He was created by A.A. Milne. Well, he was created by Christopher Robin Milne. Mm. But
yeah, we've got the Smurfs, who I guess are Hanna-Barbera. The Smurfs. Or at that point.
Yeah, created by P.O. Yeah. So, yeah.
The Muppet Babies. So, the Henson Company, I guess.
Yeah, that would be, yes. I believe at the time it was known as Ha. But
oh. Ha. Oh, yeah. Okay. Makes sense.
Henson Associates. Huh. Ha.
Yeah. They had the little stinger where Kermit's hand would put a thing out, right? Like a little piece of paper and... Wait, maybe not.
Yes.
Is that them?
Yeah, that's them. Okay. Yeah. Kermit would hang up the logo and then the letters would slide off or something.
I remember that, yeah.
And then it became the Jim Henson Company or something to that effect.
And then I think we also had... who else? Oh, Slimer from the Real Ghostbusters was in this as well.
Yes, so there's Columbia Pictures for you.
Yeah. And then, of course, the biggest star of all, a drug ghost, who actually I think was an OC in this one, an original creation.
yes, he was the He was actually the Mary Sue, the self-insertion character for the writers.
Yeah, Roy Disney was like, my persona is actually an amorphous blob of smoke that wears a three-piece suit, so be sure to put that in.
Yeah.
Actually, that makes a lot of sense, now that I think about it.
Weird to think that Roy Disney was so involved with this, but...
Yeah, you know, honestly, that, when I was reading about that, because I did a little bit of research into this in preparation for our episode.
I didn't, so please, enlighten me.
Yeah, when I say research, I mean I did about 5 minutes of Googling. But I noticed, yeah, Roy Disney was extremely involved in this. What I really want to find out was who was the brains behind this whole special, because it was huge. Like, Roy Disney executive produced it. It was funded by Ronald McDonald House and McDonald's.
Yes.
And
which is a charity, not just – it's a charity funded by the McDonald's Corporation. So presumably it was the whole special was made not for profit.
Yeah. And McDonald's apparently printed up 250 million pamphlets to advertise this thing. And then it was simulcast on every network. ABC, NBC, CBS, Fox, they all broadcasted at the same time. And apparently internationally, too. This was broadcast everywhere. So, but I really want to know, like, who thought of this? Whose brainchild was this? And I couldn't find anything on that, because everything I found was just basically internet people recapping the special, which we're going to do as well. But,
yes.
You know, and saying, like, I can't believe this happened. But it made me think of, is apparently Roy Disney was huge involved in this, and kind of seems to have been the pusher behind it. So
you think he created the story? You think it was his idea? Well, you think it was his idea to have the cartoon all-stars come to the rescue in the first place?
Well, because the thing is, I assumed at first, okay, obviously some guy in the government thought of this. Some guy tasked with, like, you know, spending a bunch of anti-drug grants that he had gotten. Was like, I got to do something about this. And came up with the idea. That's what I thought. But now I'm thinking, wait a minute. It looks like Roy Disney might have been the guy behind it, which makes me wonder, because this happened about a year after Roger Rabbit came out. So maybe Roy Disney figured out the power of the crossover. And according to everything I read, all the other license holders allowed them to use their characters for free because this was an anti-drug thing. So maybe Roy Disney was like, aha, I'll do another crossover. I'll get all their characters for free and I'll make a mint on this. I'm just spitballing here. I mean, I have no proof of that, but.
I don't know. Cause the thing about it is that I don't know how much profit you can make on it, because it's completely unre-releasable.
That's true. It was on video rental, so maybe they thought they make a lot in rentals. I don't really know. I'm not really sure. Yeah,
Well, I don't know about you, but I got shown this in school.
Oh yeah, actually, Ethan, I wanted to ask, like, what is your experience with this, or do you remember actually?
Yeah, I saw it when it first showed on TV, and then they showed it to us again, a video version in school, and it had pretty much all the same things, except, you know, I don't remember if the live television version had commercial breaks or not.
Okay, interesting.
But I do remember from the original version the introduction with George and Barbara Bush, and the little PSA with Ronald McDonald House and the singing kids.
Okay, yeah. I remember those too. You said they showed this to you in school, though?
Yeah, it wasn't like a big thing, but a bunch of classes came to the science lab, as I recall, at once to watch it. This was at Manchester Gate Elementary in Fresno, California. Go on.
I was going to ask, did you know ahead of time what you were going to see?
Well, again, I'd seen it before, but I didn't realize that we were going to sit down and watch Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue. I knew it was, they were always having these kinds of, assemblies in school. There was always an anti-drug assembly of some kind or another.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the turn between the 80s and 90s. So anti-drug stuff was big. It was the thing.
Yes.
I remember when this thing came out, because actually, Ethan, Because I was reading there was a huge promotional push for this ahead of time. Do you remember any before this coming out, like hearing about it, or was it just a thing that you saw on TV?
Nothing specifically apart from that, you know, there were commercials for all your favorite cartoon characters come together to save a mystery friend or some crap like that. And there was, I don't know, there were commercials for it, but I didn't think it was as necessarily as special or more special than any other, say, you know, Garfield or Cat in the Hat special. So.
Okay, interesting. So they did not successfully drum up excitement for you.
Well, I mean, I saw it. But
yeah, but you weren't like, I gotta see this. I gotta see Papa Smurf interact with Garfield. I actually remember, because when I saw this, when it first came out in 1990, I was living overseas at the time. My family was in Ghana, and the big thing about Ghana that I remember back then is there was not really any television there. You know, they had like one channel, and I think they showed about 20 hours programming a week, which was mostly like newscasts and just theater productions that they were filming, and Captain Planet, which was the one cartoon they actually did show.
Yeah, and I remember I think I was the one who figured out why.
Why was that?
Because of Kwame.
Oh, that's right. He was Ghanaian, or at least he's got a Ghanaian name, so he was coded as Ghanaian.
Yes, I think he is officially supposed to be Ghanaian. Kwame, by the way, if you don't remember Captain Planet, Captain Planet is a Sentai show about five kids who can summon a superhero, and one of them, voiced by LeVar Burton, is a Ghanaian kid with the power of Earth.
Oh, I did not know that was LeVar Burton, actually.
Yes.
Huh. Interesting. Well, it made sense. I think that was probably, yeah, that makes a lot of sense why they had that in Ghana. They were like, hey, local boy does good. Except LeVar Burton's not actually
I don't
Ghanaian.
Think LeVar Burton is actually Ghanaian.
No, I don't think so.
That is how you pronounce it, right?
LeVar Burton? Or Kwame?
No, Ghanaian.
Oh,
because I was looking it up, and half the stuff I saw said Ghanaian, the others said Ghananian.
Oh, so I always heard Ghanaian, but
Ghanaian? Okay,
that's my understanding.
If you lived there, well, you should know.
Yeah, I lived there for like 2 years when I was like 10, so you know, and 11.
You were 10 for 2 years.
Yeah, well, you know,
Arrested Development.
I have magical powers. But here's the thing. So there was like no television, right? I went to my life in Ghana was incredibly boring because I would go to school and come home. There wasn't really an American, there wasn't any, like mostly when I lived overseas, I lived in American communities, like army bases, but there was no army, right. U.S. Army station in Ghana. So literally I lived in a house surrounded by a wall with broken glass studded in the top because apparently the U.S. Embassy was like, oh, what if terrorists come in? Everyone needs a house surrounded by a broken glass. It was weird. But anyway.
What if Annie Lennox comes in?
Anyway, so we...
Kids, ask your parents who Annie Lennox is.
Obscure joke. But there was a place called the Officers Club, even though there were... Which I believe was a restaurant and room with a pool table. Yeah, that was the thing where if you were bored, the Americans could all go to this place and hang out and be cool. It had once been the residence of the Senegalese ambassador because it had a swimming pool shaped like the country of Senegal in the backyard. I distinctly remember this. But anyway,
wow.
The important thing about the Officers Club is that behind the restaurant, they had a bar, and in the bar, they had a giant TV, big screen TV, that had cable. So it was the only place you go to see like international cable. And it just played CNN constantly, which was just Gulf War updates at the time, because this was when we were in you know, we were in a little tiffle.
1990.
Yeah. Yeah. We were having some issues over in Iraq, which we solved and never had to go back. But anyway, one Saturday, my parents put us all in the car. We drove to the Officers Club and we were in that room with like a dozen other kids. And we're like, what's going on? We don't know why we're here. And then they just play Cartoon All-Stars The Rescue. And and I remember at the time being like, oh my God, a cartoon. I'm so excited about this. Finally, it's not just Peter Jennings talking all day. But yeah, so anyway, that's my experience with Cartoon All-Stars
The Rescue.
That was a long story. But
it definitely seems like this was something that, on both of our parts, that we got shuttled into kind of by diktat from above.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's very important that we learned that drugs are bad.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't know anything about drugs outside of what I learned from these things. So that's kind of the problem, was that they always, all of this anti-drug stuff from the 80s and 90s approached you as if you were already doing drugs.
Yeah.
And I didn't know what a fucking joint was.
Oh, that's right. I wouldn't have known drugs. Yeah, either. I vaguely know that I knew my understanding of drugs was there's a store called the drug store, but apparently that's different. That's medicine. So that was very confusing.
Well, I do remember thinking it was very funny that in San Diego, there was a thrift store. No, there was a drug store that just said drugs, and underneath it was a Coke ad. Coke is it?
Well, you know, I'm convinced. Drugs are great now.
Let's see. But in the 80s, there were some important things that they need to convince you about drugs. One, big, mean bullies will try to convince you to use drugs.
Yeah, yeah. And they also that drugs are actually extremely unpleasant to do.
Yeah. And, you know, there's no point. And I never understood why anyone would do them in the first place, because they never actually explained what a high is.
Yeah, that's right. It makes you, as far as I know, it's like, oh, if you take drugs, it's something that makes you think a guitar is a giant, crazy, evil bird, and you'll jump out a window.
Wow. I never saw that one.
But that was a gem episode. I believe the Misfits gave some of the Starlight Kids like some pills or something. I forget what actually happened, but yeah, there was a lot of that. As you know, a high, an artificial high is something you get from an unlawful substance.
Oh, like beer?
Yes. No, beer is good, but only if you're an adult. That's a dad drink.
Oh. Oh, okay. So something that you can only buy as an adult gets you high, like cigarettes.
Yeah, because that is wacko if you're a teen.
Ah.
Though those are much later ads, I believe.
Yes.
Well, anyway, I guess we should actually talk about the actual special, since that's what we were planning on talking about tonight.
Okay. Yeah, so the actual special. Now, I watched a version that was reproduced from VHS, a VHS distributed by Buena Vista, who I guess didn't really stress too hard over people pirating it, because the more people watch it, the better.
Was this, this was a Disney thing, do you think they did the usual thing of put copy protection on their tape, or did they not bother?
This one sure didn't seem to have it.
Wow.
That was what, yeah.
If
you dare try to steal bedwetting Jasper.
I was just about to say that. Bedwetting Jasper to the rescue. Again, you know.
Oh, yeah. Cartoon All-Stars and Bedwetting Jasper. Oh, man. Wouldn't it be great if it had been Cartoon All-Stars to the rescue over your bedwetting?
Oh, my God. That would be great.
And they just sent Jasper for the drugs.
That would be great. Well, I would love to see Bedwetting Cartoon All-Stars to the rescue, where it would just be Alf saying, you know, the problem is too many video games. This is a deep cut, because I believe we're the only two people. We're two of three people in the world who've seen Bedwetting Jasper to the rescue.
Yes. And we would love to share Bedwetting Jasper with you. This is the kind of thing that Mike and I do when we get together, is we watch terrible videos like these. But Bedwetting Jasper was a video actually produced by the Disney Corporation about a friendly little animated gnome whose job is to tell you that bedwetting is a medical problem and it's not your fault and you need to go to the doctor.
Yeah, yeah. And he was trying to become a wizard. Somehow helping kids with this problem gave his wizard stars on his hat or something. Or should I say he was trying to become a whiz? Heard. Yeah. Anyway, but back to Cartoon All-Stars rescuing people.
Yes.
Yeah, so this is, you said, with Buena Vista Entertainment.
Yes, and then we get to the, I believe, the first thing is the announcement from Ronald McDonald Children's Charities, which, you know, they do a lot of good work, and I couldn't find any real dirt to dig up on them. So, you know, good on you for actually starting a good company, McDonald's, regardless of, you know, whether... You know, whether kids would even have heard of Ronald McDonald anymore.
Huh.
Do you think now they've changed the name to Terrifying Grinning Red Boxes Children's Charities?
That's, I guess you're right. Ronald McDonald doesn't appear in the commercials anymore, does he?
Nuh-uh.
No, that's weird. Now they have those Minions boxes.
Yeah.
Oh, man. But
well, I'd still take the boxes over that stupid farm kid and goat or whatever was going on then.
I don't even remember that one.
Yeah, no, nobody... Nobody remembers that brief period of their other characters besides the McDonaldland characters.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah. Apparently not very popular. But then we get into the president and Mrs. President show up and explain to us that we're going to learn about how drugs are bad. And George Bush promises that some of our favorite cartoon heroes are going to show up. And I love the way he says it because he sounds so incredibly uncool. He sounds like Marge Simpson going like, "Oh, your cartoon friends are back."
Your little friends.
And
now a lot of my memories for this, of this video are tied up in rediscovering it as an ironic young adult. And a lot of those are tied in with the X Entertainment review of it.
Oh yeah. Where, yeah.
Yes, X Entertainment, now known as, well, its sequel, now known as Dinosaur Dracula.
Wow. That,
which was a beloved figure of the mid-morning of the internet.
Yeah.
And
I remember back in the days of Sean Baby and OMG Jeremy.
Yes. And Brunching Shuttlecocks.
Oh, yeah.
All that kind of stuff. Yeah. But there was... But Matt Caracappa of X Entertainment described this as the most amazing speech that George Bush ever gave because one out of two words is drugs, and every third word is either Smurfs or Slimer. And unfortunately, that's not true. But after we read that for years, my friend Steph and I, we would just, when we were trying to do an impression of George Bush, which came up more often than you would think, we would go, "Drugs, Slimer, drugs, drugs, Slimer, Smurfs, drugs, Slimer, drugs."
He's like, "Do you have any questions?" Keeping in mind they've already explained about the Slimer. Wow. I like that you apparently just random. You guys just randomly were going like, "Yes, we need to do a George Bush impression."
Yes, and this was... during the George W. Bush years too. We never really got to hang out during the Clinton years.
So. Oh, wow. That's going way back. Well, I guess that makes sense. He was very relevant at the time.
Yeah.
But man. Yeah. This is the best George Bush speech though. Yeah,
it is. I mean, and just to make sure that it's as appealing to the kids as possible, Millie is there.
Yeah. Also, I will say, The good thing about this particular George H.W. speech is that even though it's the anti-drug speech he gave, it does not involve framing a random black teenager and sending up the river. like that.
Thank you.
Yeah,
thank
like
you.
That one, like the other drug speech he did. Anyway. Anyway, getting into the actual special.
Yes.
It opens.
We fade in on a house. And we fade in on a house and a child's room, and we see a hand grab a piggy bank out from the door. And who else witnesses this piggy bank theft?
The Smurfs.
Yes, the Smurfs, who are in a comic book lying on the floor. Notice they somehow look out of the comic book and notice that the girl who owns this comic's piggy bank has been stolen. So they...
They spring into
action.
They
clamber out of the comic.
Yeah.
So I want to know, where is the window out of the comic book for the Smurfs? Is it in a building? Is it just in the sky?
Yeah. Well, if they can just look up and see into the outside world, I assume there's just a large gaping portal just there that they can, which is interesting because I guess every page they, I don't know. I'm not even going to try and figure it out. Suffice to say is like most of the cartoon all-stars are random things in this girl's room who then come to life in order to help her.
Yes.
Such as.
It's more like merchandise all-stars rescue. Because two of them are in fact her appliances.
Yeah. Garfield is a lamp.
Garfield is a lamp. That's just a Garfield with a lampshade sticking out of it. I'm amazed that it's not the Garfield phone, right. But I guess a girl her age wouldn't have a phone.
Not 1990.
No.
And then there.
And Baby Kermit.
Right. He's the alarm clock.
Yes.
Then she also has a random framed photograph of Alf.
Yeah. I mean, that is. I think back to how a close friend of mine, Dave, he's going to come up again. Mm-hmm. We were trying to do a riff of this about 10 years ago because he had done a very successful YouTube poop of Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue.
Oh, really? I
yeah.
Oh, you got to share the
link. One of my favorite parts of the poop was just a repeated shot of the photograph of Alf going, "Huh?"
That's pretty funny actually.
Yes.
but yeah, Alf comes out of the picture and probably my favorite thing about this is that you do get to see Alf interact with Garfield and threaten to eat him.
Yes.
Which is in character.
Which is exactly what would happen,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, so I really, well, as soon as I saw that happening on screen, I was like, oh, he better threaten to bore Garfield. It's like, oh, I gotta see that.
Vorfield.
Yeah, and he does, so I was very happy with that aspect of this cartoon. But anyway, and then the chipmunks appear as well. They are in a record.
Yeah, they're inside a record, which they seem to be treating as an apartment.
Yeah, well, makes sense. It's their
Does Dave live in this record too?
I think they're on their own now. They're
wow.
They're living it high as rock stars who don't do drugs. and then Slimer just comes in, and I guess Slimer is an actual ghost who lives in her house.
Yeah, he just haunts their house.
Yeah, and he eats her lamp and then shines a lamp on the spot where the piggy bank used to be in order to draw her attention to this. And which actually brings up an interesting point, I think, because this is one of the, okay, this is like one of those cartoons, like, when, you know, those cartoons where it's like toys coming to life or like talking animals and stuff, but they're also humans in that world. And you have to wonder, okay, so are aware of these things? Are these things actually happening? Is it symbolic or what's going on here? Because
they have to hide whenever they think adults might be
right.
Coming.
They always seem to be out of sight. So the girl doesn't know it, but then a ghost eats her lamp and shines light from his mouth onto that spot. So does she not realize there's a ghost there? Does she just see a beam of light coming from nowhere?
Nowhere? I mean, I don't know.
I'm not really sure. I feel like they didn't think that one through.
I want to say also that Slimer is unusually articulate in this special. You can actually understand what he's saying.
That's true, actually. I guess they were like, I guess the suits had to come down hard on that one.
Yeah.
I do like that every time a character appears, though, they do a little riff of the music that's associated with them. So you do hear the Ghostbusters theme song when Slimer appears.
Yeah, and when Pooh is her actual teddy bear, he wakes up and you hear a little bit of the Adventures of Winnie the Pooh theme song. And that, now, remember that Pooh is her teddy bear. That's going to come up again.
Yeah.
And because he actually breaks the Toy Story rule in this one.
That's right, which indicates then that she can see all this stuff. They're just staying hidden, which means that she must have seen Slimer.
She actually says,
"Oh, sorry."
She actually says, "Pooh, you never talked before."
Oh, that's right. And then he's like, "Yeah, well, now I need to tell you about drugs.
I need to tell you about marijuana."
Actually, interesting. I did read when I was doing some research, someone actually did interview Jim Cummings about this role. And he said that he specifically excised all the lines where Pooh was supposed to use modern slang to talk about drugs because it wouldn't make any sense for Pooh to know about that, which is really smart, because Pooh comes across as pretty normal in this, unlike some other characters, like when, you know, Kermit the Frog is saying, like, yeah, when your friends ask you to get wrecked, have some self-respect. It's like, okay.
Yeah, that's another thing that's going to come up here, but I hope I remember this. There's a lot that we're kind of getting ahead of ourselves with. Yeah. But maybe we should just talk about it as we come to it, is that you're going to get a lot of good advice about drugs from characters who are much younger than you and make you feel stupid.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a recurring theme here. But anyway, so the piggy bank has been stolen, and it turns out the thief is the little girl. The little girl's name is Corey, by the way, because it's
Corey.
1990.
I can remember which one of them was Corey.
Yeah. And the older brother is Michael. And so Michael has
Corey Haim or Corey Feldman.
They were all, it's Corey's all the way down in 1990. So it's Michael has broken her piggy bank, and he's like, oh yeah, $20. I can buy so much drugs with this.
Now here's the thing. His room is also full of this kind of stuff. Where are his characters?
Oh, I guess they just didn't care.
Yeah, I mean, he's not like rock posters. Why isn't this rock stars to the rescue? You know, why isn't Prince coming down like, hey, Michael, you should really give your sister a piggy bank back?
I think we know why the rock stars aren't coming out against drugs. Yeah. I don't think even kids would fall for it if we believe that.
And then Keith Richards comes out of the poster and he's like, hey, man, $20 won't buy you shit. You got to get something out of your mom's purse.
Oh, yeah. I was actually thinking, like, was $20 really that hard to get a hold of in 1990? Because he's like really excited about this $20.
Well, I mean, I think $20 is worth $40 now.
All right. So, you know, you could buy a whole two weeds, I guess. I don't know. It was expensive.
Is that?
I'm not actually sure what the rate of the weed is.
I will say that, you know, I was trying to lead up to this with the initial question about your drug history, because I've literally never bought or smoked or drank or shot or anything, any kind of drug in my life. So,
well, I don't know.
I have no experience with any of this.
I actually have bought the weed. I think I've mentioned I've bought weed exactly one time in my life. And it was when it became legal here in California, and I went up to it. I was like, I'm going to go to the dispensary and see what this weed is all about. And I went in, and then they made it up look like a real like doctor's office. And I was like, oh shit, maybe this is actually you need a prescription. And I was totally having a freak out because I was like, oh god, they're going to know that it's not. I'm just here because I want to get an artificial high from an unlawful substance. And so and then they finally call me back, and I was like, oh shit. And I go back into the back room, and it's just the head shop. And then so I was like, I don't know what I want. So I just pointed at something and I was like, give me that. And I spent about $20. It was a little tin.
Oh, wow.
It was a little tin of, I guess, actually what? Let me see. Cause I still have it. Cause it's like, what am I going to do with the weed? Cannabis infused gummies, watermelon flavor.
Oh,
sativa. So I think sativa is supposed to make you sleepy.
Really?
I'm not really sure, actually. I should have done research.
So it's a sleep aid, huh?
I think. I'm not exactly sure what the point of it is. I mostly know that when I tried it and mostly just like started getting paranoid about like a pain in my foot. So I haven't really done it again since.
Oh.
It's because as it turns out, Cartoon All-Stars The Rescue was right. Drugs are bad.
I don't know anything about it except for one person who told me that I tried crack once, and the only thing that happened was that I took a shower and for a second I thought the water was orange.
Oh, yeah, that'll happen.
That was worth it. That was totally worth the however much a crack pipe costs.
Man.
You do buy it by the pipe, right?
Yeah, that's right. That sounds right to me. I believe you go to the crack dealer and you'd be like, I would like one crack, please. Please fill this pipe with the crack.
It's for my mother. Oh no, I stepped on it. No. Now she's gonna break her back.
So what happens once Michael has bought has the money? I can't. What? Oh, that's right. Then the Cartoon All-Stars hide under his bed, and his little sister comes in and is all like, "You stole my money!" And he's like, he stashes his drug paraphernalia under the bed, and that's when the Cartoon All-Stars see it and realize
yes.
that drugs are involved. And
it's Simon who says, "If I had to hazard a guess, I would think it'd be marijuana."
Yeah, and I think Theodore's like, "What's
Simon of the Chipmunks?" Yeah. Not like, I don't know, Simon Legree.
Yeah, not like the
classic literature all-stars to the rescue.
And then I think Theodore is like, "What's marijuana?" And Simon's like, "An unlawful substance that gives you an artificial high."
What's
as opposed again, to the real like, high?
What's a high? Yeah,
it's like I'm not high on false drugs. I'm high on the real thing.
Wow.
But
I didn't know. What's a real high like?
You need crack for that.
Oh, I assumed it had something to do with Scientology, but I don't know.
Well, yeah, you got to get all your thetans removed. Surgically. What actually happens after that? I'm trying to remember.
He runs off with his sister's money and he goes to the arcade with his creepy friends.
Oh yeah. Oh man, his friends are so cool though.
Yeah.
I love the one girl in his friend who's a girl with her giant yes. like blossom hat.
Yes, I mean they sure made being a drug person real appealing in this. It was like, man, I want to hang out with these cool kids, not these baby characters.
Yeah, well, I and that's when we also meet his drug friend, who is the Cloud of Smoke, voiced by George C. Scott.
George C. Scott.
Yeah.
Where do I know him from? I mean, I know the name. Of course, I know where I know him from. Yeah. He was in They Might Be Giants.
Was he? The band?
Yeah, the movie.
There was a movie?
No, the movie that the band got its name from. Oh,
I was like, I didn't know he was in the band. Wow.
No.
He's more talented than I thought. When he was going.
No, George C. Scott was in a movie that was like a modern remake of Don Quixote. Hence the name, They Might Be Giants.
Oh, I'm actually, because I really like the idea that he'd be in there like, Particle Man. I was like, that'd be amazing. I mostly know him from Doctor Strangelove, and I think he was in The Changeling as well, but he's definitely had a long and storied career. This was one of his later roles, and not
yes.
honestly not particularly memorable. He is actually, I mean, as an actor, he's very he's got a real presence, but as a voice actor,
yes, he's
kind of weird. A weird pick.
I kind of feel like they probably didn't do a table read with George C. Scott.
Yeah, they were just like, it's George C. Scott, of course. Just, you know.
Just come in and have him read his lines. And he probably did that Orson Welles thing where he was like, drugs are... Where he's reading the drug guy's lines, and then he just goes right down and reads Bugs Bunny's lines, too, in the same voice.
You know what? I wonder if, like, they were like, talking to George Bush, and they're like, look, we need you to like introduce this this cartoon movie with like Bugs Bunny and the Teenage Ninja Mutant Turtles. And George Bush is like, I don't know who the fuck any of those people are. They're like, George C. Scott's in it. And he's like, oh, shit, I love George C. Scott because he played Patton, and I love war. So that's probably what happened. So then they're in the arcade, and they're doing a drug, but then the cops appear, so everyone scatters, and Michael runs away in his giant 80s high-top sneakers, which I...
What, you didn't have a pair of those?
I knew they existed, but you had to be cool to get those.
Oh, right.
I mean, only the cool kids had those giant sneakers.
I'm sorry, I need to keep in mind that some of us weren't cool.
Yeah, you know, it's a real problem. So I would thank you to not bring it up. Yeah. That was like,
I'm sorry for nerd shaming you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's like it's a real problem when you have like low cool levels. But it turns out it's not really a cop. It's actually Bugs Bunny impersonating a cop.
Oh, And the cops take him away for impersonating a cop, yeah. Right?
Well, you know, it's Bugs Bunny doing the thing, like, he comes, like, when he usually shows up as, like, a Viking lady riding a giant fat horse, except this time he's a cop, and...
riding a giant fat horse.
Yeah, and he comes in, and he's all like, what's this joint? Because...
so it's a big attraction.
Yeah, it's like, God, he's really kind of a narc.
Yeah. Now, okay, let's rate this by how likely the characters are to actually be anti-drug. I mean, I'll write Huey, Dewey, and Louie and the Muppet Babies right out because they wouldn't have any experience with it whatsoever.
Right.
Alvin would probably be excited about drugs. He's like, hey, this is what real MTV stars do.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Alvin is 100% like a druggie.
Simon is definitely in character and then, you know, he would be a real narc. Yeah, but. Yeah. Theodore would just be like, wait, you can put it in brownies?
Yeah, that's true. Garfield, I feel like, was kind of in character in the sense that he did not give a shit about anything. And just
no, he didn't.
Was forced into this under threat of, like, you know, death. And
Whereas Alf, I think it wouldn't... Maybe he wouldn't really know being an alien and all, but on the other hand, he'd like hosted the Tonight Show by then.
Well, so. Alf, I feel like Alf himself had struggled with drug addiction as well. So maybe that's why he was so concerned about this, because it is canon from the Alf show that Alf was addicted to eating cotton and it had similar effects to drugs on the Melmax physiology.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, as I recall, he also was prone to... he was also prone to extremely vivid and hallucinatory dreams if he ate Tabby Paw Pie before bedtime.
That's right. So, you know, this kind of fits with Alf. Who else do we have in this? Slimer?
Slimer. Slimer, really. You know, I can believe that Slimer would be anti-drug because, as everyone knows, Slimer is the ghost of Bluto.
The Bluto from Popeye?
No. What's his name?
Oh, Animal House.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, you're right. So he died of drugs. So John Belushi.
Belushi, yeah. Yes. He's the ghost. He's unofficially the ghost of John Belushi. So he would be like, God, I don't want to see this kid die of a screwdriver like I did and like Chris Farley will in 6 years.
You know what? I'll buy that. You know what? I'm conflicted about Winnie the Pooh, because Winnie the Pooh seems in character, but Winnie the Pooh also does have hallucinatory dreams about heffalumps and woozles and a crippling addiction to honey. So
yeah.
So
I think it was smarter than to keep Pooh's focus just on maintaining her relationship with her brother.
Yeah. Tigger's in this too, but he's kind of a, you know.
Yeah, he kind of pops up out of nowhere. And so do Piggy and Gonzo.
Yeah. And of course we have the Ninja Turtles in this.
We have a Ninja Turtle.
Yeah, and he's really slumming it.
It's really weird. Yeah, only Michelangelo shows up. The other three,
they just can't be.
I can see how, you know, Raphael would just be like, dude, don't be a fucking narc. And Donatello would be like, actually, most of these drugs are significantly less dangerous than you know. Perhaps you haven't heard that the level of blah, 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 blah. And then Leonardo would say some cryptic bullshit like what you put into your body cannot affect your spirit or some shit like that.
Yeah. That's true. Maybe that's why they were like, we can't have the other Ninja Turtles in this and have them in character. It's not going to work. So we'll just have the one who literally just shows up to like pull a plug so that Michael can meet some other characters. He doesn't do anything in this. But anyway, I guess we're getting ahead again. So,
Because
we're still on boat. Wait, actually, first, is that all the characters? I guess that's everyone, isn't it?
I think that's everyone, okay. Yeah.
So Bugs Bunny.
Oh, and Bugs Bunny and Daffy Duck.
Oh, that's right. I forgot Daffy Duck's in this too, isn't he? He just, I guess he's, oh gosh, Daffy Duck. You know, Daffy Duck would totally do drugs.
Yeah, I mean, let us please not forget that Daffy Duck has been claimed by the African-American community as one of their own.
Yeah. Also, you know, the other thing about Daffy Duck is I feel like he is a very Hollywood personality. So he would be totally doing like speed, like constantly, you know, just or big rails of coke. Anyway, so what else? Okay, so anyway, Bugs Bunny, right?
Right.
So Bugs Bunny is he brings out a time machine, and
which he says he borrowed from a coyote.
Yeah, which actually I really like. That's actually my favorite line of the whole special. I really enjoyed that.
Yes.
And he goes back.
I like to think that it's not a coyote that we know.
It's just a random coyote.
Yeah, it's just some coyote who happened to own a time machine. It's not Wile E. Coyote or even freaking Calamity Coyote.
He borrowed it from the Native American trickster figure Coyote.
Now that I can believe. I can believe that that Itsuyaya of the Nez Perce would actually own a time machine. But
it fits, you know. But he takes it and he goes back in time, 2 years back in time to when Michael first did drugs. And Michael's insisting that he loves drugs and does drugs because he wants to. Bugs Bunny is like, actually, you're wrong, because you only do drugs because you were forced to, because you were peer pressure or something. And
yeah, he sees his friends smoking and he comes up like all cool, like, you guys cruising for lung cancer or what?
That is, even when I saw this at like 10 years old. That is the dorkiest line ever. I was like this kid is such a tattletale.
Yes.
Why would you ever?
You know, I'm not even a smoker, and my response would have been like to high five everyone and be like, yeah, woo, lung cancer.
Yeah, seriously. Well, that's the thing, is like if
grandma died of lung cancer and I still would have done that.
I feel like, you know, okay, if you're like doing drugs and a kid comes up and says that, the last thing you're going to do is like, yeah, this is a kid that I want to offer drugs to. It's like, this kid is 100% basically going to fall down and start crying and then like tell the teacher on you. So do not give him drugs. You're wasting your own drugs. The drugs that presumably
really
you paid for.
They really seem to think that drugs that in these things, they really seem to be positing drugs as a kind of pyramid scheme that anyone who gives you drugs is trying to get you to sell them. So, and then they get a cut or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the only logical way that any of this makes any sense.
Yeah. Drugs are a sort of under the counter Amway.
Yeah. Also, yeah, they're really big into the whole gateway narrative in this thing.
Yes.
But then, I think we cut to, back to Corey. And this is the bit where this is where the dad, Corey and Michael's parents are like hanging out in the kitchen, and the dad is all like,
I guess it is his dad. I mean,
I assume it's a dad.
For some reason, I assumed that it was Corey's dad and Michael's stepdad.
Oh,
I don't know why.
Probably because he has beers in the fridge. And that's a very stepdad
thing. Yeah.
I mean, the thing is, what I like about this is he says, huh, some of my beers are missing. And the mom is like, I'm sure you just misplaced them. Who else would drink beer? And it's like, you have a teenage son. Who else do you think is drinking your beer? Seriously. It's like, God, you're so stupid. These parents are just, but,
And again, I have to say, it so undercuts your message when you were specifically showing these other people enjoying illicit drugs.
Yeah. And actually, the thing is, this beer subplot is immediately dropped, never brought up again. But what's interesting about it is when I was looking into this, apparently when they were preparing this, there were a few news articles about it, you know, advanced things, and some of the news articles interviewed, you know, experts in this thing, drug addiction and all that. Basically all the interviewers, like any politician that they interviewed was like, this is great. And any expert or psychologist or, you know, social worker that they interviewed was like, yeah, this probably won't do very much. But actually, alcohol is a much bigger problem for, like, kids than drugs, and really, you should be addressing that, and this special doesn't. And then I also read, apparently, this special was still being edited up to 3 days before it was actually aired. So I feel like they jammed that bit about the beer in as kind of a a sop to those complaints.
Oh, that was the opposite of my thought. I thought that they probably had more having to do with beer, but somebody got to them about it.
Well, you know, that is also possible. Oh, the stepdad union was like, hey, we don't like all this anti-beer stuff you're putting in. Next, you're going to say,
stepdad's not mean, he's just adjusting.
Like, originally, there's a whole subplot about like how you, beer is bad, and those sleeveless undershirts, you can't wear those. Those are bad, too. And the stepdads were like, we don't like this. Get rid of that. Like, how about this anti-gold chain plot? We don't like that either. I assume all stepdads are just Carl from Aqua Team Hunger Force, so I don't know. But anyway, so then we get to the bit where Corey is afraid to tell her parents about Michael's issue, so Pooh confronts her about that and is like, why didn't you tell your mom? And she's like, oh, Michael's going to be mad at me if I narc on him. And Pooh is like, what if you don't tattle, who will? Or something to that effect, I think.
Well, I mean, you know, how is she to know that whether he's involved with actually dangerous drugs or not? Well, obviously is, since he stole the beers. But
yeah, that's true.
But she wouldn't know. But
No. And in fact, we don't know either. It's never actually confirmed that he did steal the beers.
No.
But we're just assuming he did, because drugs.
I am imagining that Slimer had them.
Yeah. That actually would make a lot of sense. Oh, there, mystery solved. Because otherwise, I'm wondering, wait a minute, the narrative of this special is that, like, drugs are a gateway to harder stuff, like beer. Because did he start doing drugs and then move on to beer? Is that what happened? Okay. Actually, speaking of moving on to harder stuff, the next scene is another one of my favorite bits, where he's hanging out with his drug friends and they're smoking the weed. And one of them says, hey, if we have $10, we can get some crack. And the drug cloud, the ghost says, oh yeah, crack is super cool. Crack is where it's at. And which I love that line. It's like, yeah, in 1990, everyone was like, oh, crack, that's the cool drug. You don't want to be on crack right now. But then that's when they steal Michael's wallet. And
and they just yell, got your wallet.
Yeah, and then he chases.
Like, got your nose. Yeah.
And he tries to chase him down, but then he falls into the sewer and meets Michelangelo. And Michelangelo tells him drugs are bad. Or something. Yes. He probably makes a comment.
Well, he says, cowabunga, dude, are you looking for a gnarly pizza or nunchucks or something else turtle-related? Anyway, drugs.
Yeah. Michelangelo's... That's pretty much verbatim. But then he's
drugs, bud.
He's like, yeah, he's all, he says, what does he say? Something like, oh, you're all messed up on drugs. Well, I'm going to pull the plug in the sewer and Kermit will tell you more. Because then he just falls down a drain into a little carnival, like a roller coaster.
Yeah, a roller coaster that takes him on a journey through the human brain.
Yeah.
Or it's like, a journey through the human brain, as baby Kermit says. And Piggy is there, and then they go on this wild ride where Kermit talks about how drugs make you feel good for a while, but then for every high, there's a low.
I actually really enjoy this scene because, first of all, the backgrounds look like they were just taken right out of Cool World. And also Piggy and Kermit are very in character with their interaction.
Yes. This, I would actually say that I am guessing that this special was written by people who were mostly working with Muppet Babies.
Yeah.
Because they knew what they were doing here.
Yeah. I feel like the Muppet Babies are the ones who, not only are they most in character, but they probably are the closest to making an anti-drug argument in this movie.
Yes.
As opposed to everyone else who just, like, kind of tells him that he's stupid.
Now, the problem with this scene, though, is that I have it, for some reason, indelibly mixed in my mind with the scene from the very first episode of The Simpsons where Bart imagines himself on the train in the word problem. So they go past Principal Skinner spraying out the speed limit.
So this did not effectively make you not want to do drugs at all.
Mostly it just made me no, they must be kicking themselves. They didn't wait until next year to do this so they could have had Bart Simpson.
Oh my God. Yeah. Yeah, that's true. And then he could have been like, he could have come in and say like, drugs can eat my shorts. And, or he'd be like, I'm Bart Simpson. Who the hell are you, man? Cause you look like you've been doing drugs.
I'm Bart Simpson. What the hell are drugs?
There you go. Or he could do the thing like, you didn't see me do drugs. You can't prove nothing. I'm just remembering all the slogans from t-shirts.
Watch out for the rock. I will kill you. He means it, dude.
Watch out for this rock of crack.
Crack rock.
It's crack rock. He'll kill you. Well, he means it. Oh, man. But so they do this roller coaster ride through the human brain, and they show that, like, you know, drugs make your brain go insane. And
insane in the membrane.
Yeah, and then I think they
and then he just sort of wakes up in the middle of the park.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that's right, because he's stuck in his brain while in the real world he's skateboarding drunk. It looks like.
Oh.
He just crashes out and he's lying just on the, you know, he's lying in the park going, help me, help me. Ooh. And then he just wakes up, but then Huey, Dewey, and Louie show up and he's like, oh man, I'm tripping out.
I'm seeing ducks.
And
I'm seeing duck bull.
He's like, I'm seeing triple. Nine nephews. Ducks.
Nine ducks. Yeah. Yes.
And then he's like, I gotta get off these generic drugs. And the Huey, Dewey, and Louie are like, drugs, that's bad.
Yes.
But then they have the musical number, and all Cartoon All-Stars show up and say and sing a song about how you can say no to drugs.
Yes, the million wild and wonderful ways to say no, which I think is the best known part of this whole special, really.
Apparently it was written by the people who did the Little Mermaid soundtrack.
Yeah. Slumming it.
Yeah,
again.
Really not their best work. But it does have the line where Kermit says to get wrecked, let's get wrecked, which is still great. I still love that one.
Now, the song itself kind of reminds me of a song from the Pinocchio Christmas special, if you've ever seen that one.
Is that a Puppetoon one?
Yes, it's one by Rankin Bass.
There's like the sleigh driver who goes, ha, ha, ha.
Sorry, what?
Is there like a evil sled driver who does a song where he goes, ha, ha, ha? Is that in that?
I don't remember that. Okay. It's the one where Pinocchio comes to Santa's workshop to teach the toys to dance, and he has this song that sounds like Dancing Machine because it was like 1979 or something.
I wonder if that's the same one. Is there a doll that's just a doll, but he wants her to be alive?
Yes.
Oh yeah. Okay.
There is a doll.
I do remember.
Okay.
That. Yes. Okay.
But there's a song in it where Geppetto is fretting over what to get people for Christmas, which is silly because he's destitute himself. Yeah. But
also he's a toy maker.
But the song. Yeah.
It's like, gosh, I wonder
but
what
the song
I could give
has
people.
A. Yeah. I could give. Oh, I know. I could make Pinocchio a wooden puppet as a gift. Wait a minute.
It's like getting a little meta there.
Yeah. But no, the song, it feels a lot like the million wonderful ways to say no.
Oh.
I never know what gifts to buy to you.
Yeah.
On all my lists are things scratched out. You too.
I do remember that. Then there's a bit where Pinocchio kicks him in the ass and his hair flies off.
Yeah.
Oh, memories.
Oh, my wig. Yeah, that was something. That's directly from the book. Yeah, that was something that Disney left out, was that Geppetto always wears a huge, oversized blonde wig that doesn't really look good on him at all.
Huh. What an idiot. He's a...
And everyone calls him, you know, cornmeal or something because of it.
Oh, actually, no, I feel bad for him. It's kind of,
yeah.
That's mean. Oh, poor guy.
They cornmeal.
I mean, I shouldn't laugh. That'll be me in a couple of years. So,
yeah, cornmeal.
Oh, everyone always makes fun of me for my love of corn. Anyway, what happens? Oh, yeah, so they do the song, and after the song, what happens after the song?
Also, during the song, like I said, my friend Dave and I, we were trying to do a riff of it, so we kept trying to come up with new ways to say no, and my favorite one that he came up with was, "Go count your dick!"
Okay, one. That didn't take long. Actually, though, that would be pretty effective. I mean, yeah. if someone's like, "You want drugs? Go count your dick." Like, okay. I guess that was a no. It's like, well, you know, if you're gonna be, that's your attitude, then fine, I won't share my drugs with you.
And of course, if it's a lady, go count your dick. Zero.
Yeah, it's like, that was quick. What a ride. Oh man. Why didn't you guys ever actually do this? This sounds like,
or unless you're a lady who has a dick, of course. There are quite a few.
Yeah, that's true. You guys actually should have done this, though.
Yeah, we should have. I've still got my my half that I was recording in the same way that we do this podcast, but I don't have his. I should see if he's still got it.
Yeah, we could release it as a companion episode to this.
Yes!
the bonus content. But so they do the song, and then they... what comes after the song? Let's see.
Is that where they just go hog wild into the crazy carnival?
Oh, almost. So first they the little girl comes
Corey.
In. Corey goes in the room.
Corey Feldman.
Yeah, Corey Feldman. In the room. And Michael comes in and like yells at her. And then Alf pulls him through a mirror. And I think then we start going kind of crazy carnival. And because Alf does this weird thing where he's taking him through a hall of mirrors and like showing him like, basically like a funhouse mirror version of himself, like, look, you look like Gollum. And
yeah,
and it's like, well,
and he's horrified by this,
but we can actually see
that's
him,
something else,
and it's inaccurate. He doesn't actually look like that. He looks
no.
fine. But he is very horrified, and he does that thing where he's like, I can quit anytime I want, but it turns out he can't because he's addicted.
And that's when they go on this extremely hyperkinetic bounce through this giant circus carnival funhouse that honestly makes being on drugs look freaking awesome.
Yeah, I mean, let's be honest. If you were watching this and by this point you weren't already thinking, "Huh, maybe if I do drugs, I can meet all my cartoon friends," then you would think, "Well, you know what? This Pink Floyd trip looks pretty sweet, actually." But yeah, it's this, what, he's on a roller coaster. Huey, Dewey, and Louie are trying to kill him with a roller coaster.
Yes.
And
he goes, there's like a psycho carousel with where all the horses have Huey heads.
Yeah.
Angry Huey faces.
And then he gets like, he falls in a soda and he gets bored by Miss Piggy. And, you know, she
spits him out like a watermelon seed.
Yeah. And then there's a lot of this, and then he
gets flushed down the sewer, and Pooh happens to be in the sewer, and he just watches him fall for a second. I wonder if Pooh had like a funny line there that got cut out. It was like,
yeah,
well, there he goes down to the sewer, and they call me Pooh.
Oh, this must have been one of the drug references that Jim Cummings cut. Who was like, oh, you won't be chasing the dragon much longer, Michael. That's actually really bad Pooh voice.
Yes.
My Pooh voice is mostly the baseball crank from Chopper Trap House, so I'm not really good at impressions, but...
Pooh voice is... I don't know. That's a Sterling Holloway voice. You have to really kind of put
go.
Some sheep into
oh,
it.
Oh, that's actually... Yes. Yeah, no, that's good. That actually sounds like Pooh.
Yes.
But then he goes into a fortune
Michael.
Teller.
Yes.
And it's Daffy Duck. And
yes, making his first appearance, by the way.
Yes. And
you know, it's funny, Daffy and Bugs are never shown interacting, even though you would think they would be hanging out together.
That's true.
Much like Roger Rabbit, for that matter.
Oh, you're right, actually.
Isn't that weird about when Roger Rabbit, we see Disney and Warner Brothers' two biggest stars together at the same time, and then we see their two biggest stars at the same time. And so, I mean, Roger Rabbit was, I think it was, also again, our friend Steph, who described it as the world's biggest and most prolonged "his cookie is bigger than mine" fight of all time.
Accurate. Yeah, because you're right. It's like Donald and Daffy, and then you have Mickey and Bugs.
Yeah.
Yeah, they never.
But no, who's the Warner Brothers equivalent of Goofy?
Is there one? Geez, who's third banana in Warner Brothers canon?
It would be Porky.
Yeah, I guess it would be. But
I don't know. Gee, Porky and Goofy as a team up. Can you? I don't know. That would be kind of weird.
Yeah.
Porky is more of a kind of a straight man than anything else.
Yeah, it seems like. Yeah, you. Well, you know, I guess. But usually in the comics, you would team up like Mickey and Goofy, and Mickey's basically straight man.
Yeah.
I guess it would kind of work, but the thing is, like.
Yeah, I guess so.
I don't know. It just seems
kind of like kind of Abbott and Costello-ish. Yeah, kind of. Yeah.
I mean, I can't see it working as maybe it would work if you have a whole, like, plot arc in order to establish their interactions, but I feel like as a quick gag, it would be kind of weird. It wouldn't really gel very well. I don't know. Maybe it would. I've obviously never seen it happen. So, you know, when they do, when they finally do, you know, Roger Rabbit, you know, The Next Generation or whatever.
Yeah.
I'm sure they'll reboot it sooner or later.
You know about the movie they almost made?
What? Which one?
It was going to be called Who Discovered Roger Rabbit.
Like a prequel?
And it was going to, yes, it was going to be about how Roger and Baby Herman met in the army.
Okay, that actually could be very interesting. Are they like going to be like, what do you call it? Like USO entertainer type guys?
No, they were going to be in the infantry in an all-tune platoon.
Oh, okay. Interesting. And I guess they'd be, I would like to see them fight some Nazi cartoons. That would be great. Actually.
Yes.
I'm trying to think of,
oh man. Yeah. Take on Reynard.
Yeah. Oh yeah. That's right. And that
awful anti-Semite Reynard.
Yeah. That's the
creature.
One. I remember.
Yeah.
That's the extent of,
We are getting in some deep cuts here. You got to really be up on your stupid cartoon history to remember this stuff.
I try to think like other, or like just be fighting like caricatures from the Gift Pilts, you know, I would, which would be great to see them get, oh gosh, I don't know this. But then again, I'm thinking like, that's actually kind of, no, that'd be bad because then it's like, it's like, wait, but they're fighting a Nazi caricature of a Jew, which actually implies they're beating up Jews, but
no,
that's not good. Yeah. Okay, I don't. Who is the Nazi? Okay, I guess the question is who was Hitler's mascot?
Yeah, who would be Toon Hitler?
Yeah,
who
was?
Oh,
yeah.
Struhl Peter.
Oh yeah, there you go. That's perfect. Oh shit, that'd be awesome. I love this idea. Oh man, actually, yeah. And then you just have like now I'm thinking. Okay, now I'm thinking of like all the German cartoons. Like they'd have to fight like Pumuckl. They'd have to fight the Sandman.
Oh shoot!
Yeah, who else was? What other great German cartoon characters exist?
I'm only coming up with Belgian stuff.
That's right. They were kind of
back in the '80s. They were really into Belgium.
Yeah. Gosh.
Like the Smurfs and the Snorks and Lucky Luke. And
yeah, actually, I think most German cartoons are just imported, you know, from, you know, but I can't think of a single. Oh, well, I guess there's Fix and Foxy. Oh, my God, no. You know who they'll be fighting?
Who?
Uncle Dagobert.
Uncle Dagobert?
Yeah. He's the German version of Uncle Scrooge, who is huge over there. So they'll be fighting all like Disney characters, but evil Nazi clones of them.
Oh wow! Like the Fanta of Uncle Scrooge.
Yeah. So it'll be like Uncle
Fanta
Dagobert
Phantoms.
With Fix, Trix, and Fox, or whatever the hell his nephews are named.
Trick,
in German.
Track, and Trock, or whatever their names are. Yeah.
Oh, And Tricks and Tracks, who are the German Heckle and Jekyll. And of course, Fred Feuerstein, the evil Nazi Flintstone. Oh, man. Okay, anyway.
Anyway, Cartoon All-Stars.
Yeah, this is great.
You know, we've actually done a very good job of keeping on task until now.
Yeah, this is the best we've... Well, you know what? This is a much better subject than Sabrina Online.
Yes. And, yes. We apologize to Sabrina fans, yes. But no.
Then Daffy Duck does the thing where he says... he's trying to do a crystal ball routine, but he's got a bowling ball. And Michael says, "That's a bowling ball." And Daffy says, "That would explain the 7-10 split." And it's like, I don't, what does that mean? I guess
all I see in your future is one word, Brunswick.
See, that would actually make more sense. That would actually work as a joke because the thing is, I understand it's a bowling term, but you don't look at a bowling ball and see bowling futures. I don't know what that, I don't understand.
I'm going to invest all my money in bowling futures.
The stock market, that market will never crash. It's always a bull market when it comes to the bowling
futures. A bowl market.
A bowl market, if you were.
Yes.
But then Daffy is like, "Here's the real future," and he basically shows him the closing scene from Brazil.
Where he's strung out on a mattress or something. It's like the last chapter of the Basketball Diaries.
Yeah. And he's doing the thing where he's all, "Oh, I'm all jittery and I look like a ghoul." And then all the Cartoon All Stars come in and tell him, like, give him like kind of like a pep talk. And like Bugs is like, "What's up? Is your life if you keep doing drugs?" And
yeah, again, this is something that they touched on X Entertainment, but I always loved how he put it. Was that they spent the whole special telling him drugs are going to kill you, and he was like, he blew it off. But now they tell him drugs are going to make you look ugly, and he's like, "No."
Well, you know, their fate's worse than death, like being ugly. I'm sure glad I'm
not.
I'm getting back at you for being making fun of my uncoolness. I kid, you're not ugly.
Aww. It's okay. I've made my peace with it.
Oh, I've seen. Don't feel bad. I've seen much uglier people. In theory. Oh, no, I can't. I'm sorry. This is
it's just a bit, folks.
Yeah, it's just it's a bit. It's a skit. I should apologize. Because, like, when I did I used to be on a previous podcast with, like, another friend, Orlina.
Yes.
And we did bits like this all the time. And people would always approach me at cons and be like, "Why is Orlina so mean to you?" And I was like, kind of a joke.
Yeah.
You know, it's okay.
You should know if you ever worry about it, no, we are absolutely the best of friends. We do this as a way of setting apart time to spend with each other every week, and it works out really well.
Yeah. Pretty much talking about the cartoon is secondary, to be honest. Most of the folks listening will probably have figured that out by now.
I mean, this is what, the 8th episode?
Yeah, and I think we've managed to do a combined total of maybe 20 minutes of actual cartoon talk in it all.
Yes.
But anyway, so now that Michael has realized that he's going to be ugly, he finds a strength to kick the habit of drugs. And I think Corey is in his room and she's all like, "Oh, I found Michael's drugs, and maybe if I do drugs... maybe that'll be good, and we can get along again.
We can be friends
again." And he comes out, and he's
I mean, that's true, because, I mean, I've talked about this before, but my brother and I didn't have the best relationship growing up, and, you know, I always wanted to do the things he was doing to be closer to him, so...
Yeah, it makes
sense. So, I mean, they actually maybe completely accidentally touched on something that resonated with me. Yeah. But I never saw him doing drugs though, even though, you know, he actually did. He smoked a few joints while I wasn't looking. Yeah. But
well, you know what?
It wasn't a part of his personality. Yeah. So
well, I guess you're right, because I think like this is actually a much more you're right. It would resonate a lot more with the kids. Like how many kids get into drugs because they want to, you know, they want to get along with maybe a sibling, as opposed to how many kids get into drugs because, a bully, laughed at them. You know, it's like, I don't know one way or another, but I assume more of the former, maybe.
Well, speaking of which, can you believe that they got all the way through the all the million wonderful ways to say no, and Michelangelo did not suggest, "I'm no chicken, you're a turkey"?
Yeah, that's right. I actually was very surprised because I thought that they did say that in this, but maybe I was misremembering like one of the many parodies that I've read of this that actually mentioned that. Because I was like, wait, isn't there? Don't they say that? But that was a drug commercial at some point, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was an anti-drug commercial where a kid is getting cornered by one of those drug sales bullies that you saw so often, and then we zoom out to the actual animated Ninja Turtles watching them.
Oh,
and
wow.
And the turtles are like, "Well, what should he do in this situation?" And Michelangelo's like, "Get a pizza."
Yeah. Okay. Pizza is my anti-drug.
And they zoom in and back on the kid and to see his reaction. And of course he looks the bully right in the eye and says, "Go count your dick." No, he says, "Yeah, I'm no chicken. You're a turkey." And she's like, "Oh my God, you can never get called a chicken again, because now everyone has the perfect response."
Yeah. Well, I like, he was like, "I'm not a chicken, you're a turkey." And, the drug dealer, like, he just turns the camera, like, his mouth drops, and, like, a giant, like, stamp comes out and just stamps on his "owned." It's like, oh, man, I wouldn't want to be that drug dealer now. Woo, he just got wrecked. Oh, man.
You took it in a much more meme-y direction than I was expecting. I thought you were going to say that he was going to have flags flying out of his out of his ears, and his eyes are going to be flashing like in Crazy Mixed Up Pup.
Oh, yeah. Just, da-da-da-da-da. His head was just going to explode. It was like, "Wah!" Oh, man. But, that is kind of...
Or freeze on his face and then just cue, "Oh, yeah."
Yeah. He was just like, "What?" Oh, man. Yeah.
Take that, drug dealing bullies.
Drugs.
You've just been conniff.
You know, I never actually saw that drug commercial as a kid. The one drug commercial I distinctly remember was there was one where, what is it? There was like a bunch of like dancing kids, and it was like, "No, no, it's hip to say no." I just remember that one very distinctly. That one and the one where they just show you a bunch of like people, like it was in black and white, and people being chased by like cops and stuff. And like,
And it's like, "When I grow up, I want to be a track star."
Yeah, yeah. And like, "Nobody said I want to be a junkie when I grow up. Don't do drugs." And then.
And every single kid watching says, "I want to be a junkie when I grow up." There.
Yeah. Or they do the one where they're like, the guy is like, "They say drugs make you like, bad. Well, I'm not bad." And then his mom is like, "Ryan, you look for a job today." And they're like, "Drugs can make you do nothing too." And I'm like, "Joke's on you. We're millennials. None of us did anything."
No. Speaking of which, we'll get to that when we get to the song reprise. But one that stuck with me was, this one has a twist ending. There's this one that has all these kids hanging around looking stoned out of their minds, and they look at the camera and go, "Blah." Blah 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 blah. Blah 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 blah. And then it cuts to one of them picking up books because it's a literacy commercial.
What?
Yeah, because it's like, you don't want to have nothing to say. Read a book.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I thought it was about drugs. I remembered it as being about drugs, but it was about books.
Well.
You'd think that I would remember that.
Well, books are just as bad as drugs when you think about it. They give you ideas. Yeah.
Hang on. Oh, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein is some good stuff.
anyway, so where...
Did you recognize I was supposed to be making a bong noise, or did it just sound like obscene slurping?
I actually, I got it halfway through. At first, I thought you were making the noise of the gelatinous giant in the Phantom Tollbooth cartoon, being scared by ideas.
Better idea.
Which honestly would be kind of be on brand for you, since you
it would
you did a very good video on the Phantom Tollbooth.
That's right. Everyone, go watch it now. Yeah,
that was my that was my introduction to the book, actually, because I only knew the cartoon.
Oh, really? You'd never read the book?
Yeah, never read the book. Why would I read?
You saw the movie before?
I've seen a movie.
Okay.
That was
because the movie is still very good and amazingly true to the book compared to most things. So.
Yeah. Well, Chuck Jones.
Yep. Chuck Jones. He knew what he was doing.
Yeah. Anyway, so what?
For one thing, he wasn't involved with Cartoon All-Stars or the rest
of
it.
No, he was not. Actually, they're... Yeah, you're right. God, so what happens next? Oh, so he kicks the habit. So now he no longer does drugs. And,
yeah. George T. Scott is out of the picture.
Yeah. But he might be back for the sequel. So, watch the skies. George C. Scott will return in Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue 2.
Secret of the Ooze.
Secret of the Ooze. Or Electric Boogaloo. Or
Lost in New York. Through the Portal of Time.
or Cartoon All-Stars versus the World Crime League. Or what other ones are there?
Cartoon All-Stars Raid Again.
Cartoon All-Stars All-Star Harder. anyway, so yeah, then they, I think it just, I guess it ends about there. And
it ends there, but on a really weird note, instead of returning to their albums and lampshades and so forth, all the cartoon characters jump onto a poster in Corey's room.
You're right.
Including Pooh.
Whoa.
And Pooh is her teddy bear.
Whoa. Wait a second. Okay. So that raises several questions.
She gave up her teddy bear to save her brother, I guess.
Wow. That's wait a second here. But that implies that for some reason, Corey has a poster of all the characters that appeared in Cartoon All-Stars The Rescue together, which would imply it's a Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue poster, which would imply that in the world of Cartoon All-Stars The Rescue, Cartoon All-Stars The Rescue is also an actual cartoon that you can watch on TV and buy merchandise
for. You know, I would love to have that particular poster. Unfortunately, I don't think you can get a poster apart from the VHS cover.
Yeah, I don't think that you're right. I don't think they are really merchandise this. Which is crazy when you consider that I believe Disney owns it. So that means that Corey is technically a Disney princess.
Hey, yeah. And Michael could appear as a summon in Kingdom Hearts.
Oh, man. Oh, my God. I would love to see the Kingdom Hearts level based on this with a George C. Scott Heartless. Oh my god. Oh boy.
Oh, he could be an epic Mickey. A Beetleworks based on him.
Oh my god, amazing. Disney is leaving a lot of money on the table with this, you know? But I think I guess then they have the ending with which has another song.
It's a soft, tinkly adult contemporary version of The Million Wonderful Ways to Say No, where all of the characters take a single line, so it feels kind of like We Are the World.
Oh, yeah, it does. It really does.
It really feels like they're all standing together with wearing those headphones, swaying in time as they sing, and I think Tigger has the line, "You'll even outgrow us one day."
Oh.
And it's like, oh, I got news for you, Tigger. Nobody did.
No.
We're still talking about this 30 years later.
That's right. It's like, 30 years later, it's like, so 30 years later, this is the only thing that we do anymore, endless arguments about pop culture.
Well, it's either that or we blow up synagogues and shit. God.
Yeah, it's the lesser of two evils. Man. Worst possible timeline. Thanks a lot, Cartoon All-Stars The Rescue.
Yes. Where were you when we needed you? Where were the Cartoon All-Stars to stop 9/11?
Yeah. Hey, that actually brings up an interesting question, though. If they were to remake Cartoon All-Stars The Rescue today, which Cartoon All-Stars would there be in it, do you think?
I think some people would... I think you'd have multiple different ones for different ages. Mm. You could have educational cartoon all-stars that would be like Nick Jr. characters, like Dora and so forth. Yeah. And then you would have modern cartoon all-stars, and that would be like characters from the Adventure Time era.
Right. Okay. So.
And then you could have one that was all licensed cartoon all-stars to the rescue, and that's where you'd have your... That's where you'd have your Transformers and G.I. Joe and stuff. Mm. Okay. And then, of course, there's anime all-stars to the rescue.
Okay. that just makes me think that they're like, they're inside, Michael's head when he's like drunk on the skateboard. And they're like, Shinji, you need to pilot Michael's head. get in the head. I don't know any modern anime, so.
If we're going to cite anime from the actual time, then Amy from Sailor Moon would be under his bed and she'd be like, to hazard an educated guess, I think he's been looking at Moe.
Oh my god. Wait, oh god. Now I'm thinking that obviously he would have what do you call it? One of those body pillows? Of Sailor Moon, yes. Would come to life and be like, and those little statues where you can look up their skirts. So all his awful anime masturbation aids coming to life.
And then at the end, they all jump onto a poster, and he's like, "Yay, I'm free!" Oh my god, that was $12,000 that just jumped onto a poster.
They just jump onto one of those giant scrolls. Oh my god.
That was all sucks to be you, Michael.
It's like, oh no, all my imports. Oh my god. What
what would you include?
In anime,
Or any cartoon all-stars. What would you want them? What would you want them to come to the rescue of?
Oh, their kids don't really do drugs anymore, do they? So I guess.
They kind of don't. I mean, a lot of the problems of that generation are maybe not cured, but they're not an epidemic anymore.
Okay.
I mean.
Oh no.
Teen pregnancy is down 50% since I was a teenager, so that's much much less of a deal. So we can't do a story about Corey wanting an abortion when she's growing up or anything like that. But
I think what it would be, it's about school shootings, and basically the cartoon, Corey would be like, you know what, maybe we should outlaw guns, and the cartoon also was like, whoa, 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 actually, the only way to stop a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun. We need to arm teachers.
Jesus.
It would be
Let's not forget that the Cartoon All-Stars have to actually be in the wrong.
Yeah. that would be great, because first off, you'd have the modern Cartoon All-Stars The Rescue. First of all, the introduction would be Donald Trump being like, yeah, these cartoons are the best. My favorite cartoons are in this. I was talking to them and they said that I'm the best president. I've got the most presidential cartoon introduction. It's right now. Because obviously he would actually...
Well, that's better than... That's better than my thought. I thought they were just going to skip right to having Joe Biden doing it, whether he wins or not.
Oh, God. Actually, that brings up something that I need to say that I had completely forgotten about, but I need to mention this, is that remember we were talking about how there was all this lead up to the premiere of Cartoon All-Stars The Rescue. And
yes.
they we're interviewing, you know, they were doing all this promotion. Well, apparently, before it premiered on TV, they did a special screening in front of Congress so that our representatives could watch Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue and comment on it. And apparently, our good pal, Joe Biden, watched it and was like, oh, I'm really excited about this. Because apparently what they showed them, they said like, okay, look, we only have 15 minutes of footage to show you and we don't have all the music yet. And Joe Biden is like, says, this is a direct quote, I know what I'll be doing Saturday morning. I really want to hear that music. So Joe Biden was desperate to hear a million wonderful ways to say no. So Joe Biden, always
your creepy uncle, yeah, from the beginning.
Always on brand. Vote Warren. Anyway, so we get the president in the beginning, and then it would be like 20 minutes of like awful gun violence stuff with Twilight Sparkle is defending the Second Amendment, and Dipper from Gravity Falls being like, actually, Blue Lives Matter. do you remember that old YouTube video, conservative cartoon, All Stars the Rescue?
No.
You remember this? It was...
Which video?
It was basically, I think that was the name of it. It was clips from old cartoons, and they just dubbed in like ridiculous conservative talking points. And so it was like, there was a...
is this from the same person who did the video of Donald Duck listening to Glenn Beck?
Possibly. The main thing I remember is that like one bit, it had the Transformers doing some battle, and at the end they say, we have finally defeated Decepticons. Now, if only we could outlaw abortion. And then it had like G.I. Joe beating up Cobra, and Cobra is like, actually, Noam Chomsky says that...
I have to look this up. Yeah,
it's pretty amusing, actually. But anyway, is there? I guess that's about it. Is there anything else that we should say about Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue?
Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue, I mean, I don't want to say it was a bad idea, but it was wrong-headed in a lot of ways. There are certainly worse ways to get kids' attention than by having a giant cartoon crossover, but as this was during one of our darkest political eras, honestly. Yeah. So
I think I can say with utmost confidence, and after watching Cartoon All-Stars the Rescue, that drugs are extremely cool and it would be right and proper for everyone to do them.
Is that you talking or the purple ghost coming out of your ear?
Well, we're pals. We're buddies to the end. I'm in charge of my own life, I'm the man in my own head. No one rules me. I guess that's Cartoon All-Stars the Rescue.
Cartoon All-Star. Oh, and Garfield was in it. That was
Garfield was on brand, and then he kept talking about lasagna, I guess.
Yeah, he brought it up for no reason.
I feel like you said that this was mostly the Muppet Babies people writing it, and they were like, what's Garfield famous for? Lasagna. Yeah, lasagna. Okay.
And sleep.
Yeah, sleep and lasagna. I mean, they're not wrong, but he's just like, yeah, the only things I can know is that drugs are bad and the sizzle of lasagna is good.
Yes.
Lasagna is my anti-drug. But yeah.
Lasagna is not even that loud.
No, it's not. Also, I always thought it was weird as a kid that he specifically liked lasagna as opposed to every other Italian food, because it's like, it's basically all the same. Pasta with tomato.
I don't know. Personally, maybe I have a touch of Garfield in me because I really like baked pasta, and I only kind of like boiled pasta.
Baked pasta? Oh, would that be like a casserole, or what would you have in baked pasta?
Yeah, lasagna.
But don't you have to boil it before you bake it?
Yeah, but you uh, Yeah, but it's the baking part that, you know, gets it to absorb the flavors of the other food that it's cooking with.
Actually, yeah, you got a point, and it does make it kind of nice and crispy.
And also, actually, yes, there is lasagna noodles that you don't have to bake first, or that you don't have to boil.
Actually, you know what? You're right. I retract my earlier statement, because now I'm actually kind of feeling like lasagna, so...
Okay, well, sounds like Mike needs a midnight snack, so... Mike, you have anything you want to plug?
As always... Oh, actually, yes, I do! So, as you might know, I'm on the Twitters. And my normal account is Bitter Corella, but I have a brand new account that everyone should follow as well. It's called Midnight_Pals. And it's basically my previous viral thread wherein various horror authors got to be part of Nickelodeon's Midnight Society and tell scary stories. It's now its own Twitter. And it's very funny, so... follow it.
It is one of my favorite things that Mike has done, so I absolutely recommend it.
Yes, absolutely. You heard it here first. And Ethan, is there anything that you want people to know about?
Well, you can always see more of me at thehungerreader.com, including some of you might even be watching this podcast there if I've ironed out the problems that are keeping me from uploading it in the first place. But I also have a new project to announce that will be up by the time you're. By the time you hear this, even though I haven't actually launched it just yet, it's my new Tumblr at Daily Dumpties at Tumblr.
Oh, what's this now?
Oh, it's similar to Midnight Society, except rather than a successful viral thread, this one never got viral, but I'm going to try and push it real hard anyway, where I'm just going to upload a new picture every day of Humpty Dumpty. Because no one can decide what he's actually supposed to look like.
Oh.
And then I'm going to rate them.
Ooh, actually, I can see this being quite fun, because Humpty Dumpty,
yes.
Wow. The
most famous egg in all of literature.
There is, yeah. Humpty Dumpty's fascinating, because there's no accepted characterization of that character, even though he is, you know, so famous. So every time I see him appear in any sort of media, I'm like, oh. Okay, he's different.
Humpty Dumpty is a mysterious character. Well, on purpose, because after all, his rhyme is a riddle at heart.
Oh, that's right.
You'll always hear people say, "You never hear, you know, why do we always draw Humpty Dumpty as an egg when it never says he is one?" It's because it's a riddle, like the ones that Bilbo and Gollum tell each other, and an egg is the answer. So,
spoilers much?
Yeah, sorry.
I was. Yeah.
Well, if you want, he could also be a canon, but.
What? Oh, actually, I think I've heard that.
Yes.
Huh.
In the Fables comics, he was actually both. That was kind of funny.
He was an egg canon?
Yeah, he was a. Yeah, they introduce Humpty Dumpty as he's trying to escape from this mental hospital to convince Fables that they're not Fables. And. As they're being hunted down, he turns around and fires himself off for the first time in years. But he's like, oh, that was a lot better for me when I was made of iron. Ow! And he crumbles.
Oh, jeez. Ooh.
But they put him back together again.
Oh, they were able to, apparently.
Yes.
Yeah, I guess those horses
actually,
are just lazy.
It happens again, and this time they have to leave his shell behind, and the bad guy puts him back together and makes him a deviled egg.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's pretty rad. Man. Oh, Fables is a good comic, you guys.
I will have to check it out one of these days.
Yeah.
All right.
Actually, that was in the spinoff Jack Offables, or I mean Jack of Fables. they make that joke in it. So.
I've got a whole folder of Jack Offables. I keep them next to my Lunchables.
Lunch of Fables.
So I hope I don't mix these two things up. That would be quite the pickle.
Well, yeah, but if you find a pickle, it's not your Lunchables.
Yeah. Or is it? Oh, boy. Okay. I think that's about it for Cartoon All-Stars, The Rescue, and related topics. I guess we'll see you next time.
We'll see you next time. Think of another wonderful way to say no.